Hello everyone, my name is Bradley. I have a bad taste in music, and as promised, today I'm going to be reacting to the new Fiona Apple album, Fetch the Bolt Cutters. The reception of this album has been extremely positive, but I've never really been a huge Fiona Apple fan, which is why I made sure to prepare before I got into this album. I listened to her last album, The Idler Wheel is Wiser, the first... not really my cup of tea, but as I just kept listening, she really has a beautiful way of songwriting. This album's 13 songs, 51 minutes. Hopefully it's not going to be a snooze fest. We got a lot to listen to, let's not waste time. First track, I Want You to Love Me. Jesus Christ. What the fuck was that outro, man? Okay, that was a powerhouse of a track right there. Yeah, it's pretty solid. So I'm going into this album with, honestly, not that high of expectations. I don't really trust Pitchfork at all for anything. That was such a relaxing cut, too. It definitely reminded me a lot of what was going on in her last album. It's definitely intriguing so far. She's maybe saying here that it's destiny that she's together with this person. Maybe even she's saying, like, other people she's been with, it's all kind of led back to this moment. Wow, there's a lot to pull out of that track. All right, that was a good intro track. It's also really calming, too. Yeah, I love the chorus of this, where just that note is just, like, led out. Shameika? What the f***?
Said I had potential.
Apple had a tough time forming friendships, and she celebrates when Shameika, a tough girl from her school, tells her that she doesn't need to settle for girls who don't want to be her friend. Cool, so it's kind of an uplifting track here.
Wasn't afraid of the bullies, and that just made the bullies worse. Working Gloria in ecstasy state. That's my bird, my dream. My dog and my man and my music is my holy trinity. Working Gloria in ecstasy state. That's my Sebastian said I'm a good man in a storm.
It's kind of interesting how at the very end of that verse she seems to embrace what other people have pretty much said about her, taking it in as her own little thing. Like she says, Sebastian said I'm a good man in a storm. Tony said that she's pissed off, funny, and warm. By the end of this verse, she's pretty much just saying it herself. Like she takes in all this stuff. Maybe that's what the whole track is about. Wow, this ending's awesome. That's a nice sound play. I'll say immediately off the bat, the first two songs are very complete. There's something still mysterious about this. Like, I understand the track and what's going on. There's still a lot of stuff in here where you can tell she's conflicted. You can tell that she's trying to figure stuff out on her own. She's embracing all these other people's criticisms. Not even criticisms, but just observations about her for her own. That's a track I gotta come back to. Yeah, nice. All right, next track, Fetch the Bolt Cutters, the title track. It's a really interesting beat.
The mall clients, the chiller means, and the end. All the VIPs and PYTs and wannabes.
I've been thinking about when I was trying to be your friend. I thought it was then, but it wasn't. It wasn't genuine. Which, it's interesting, the first track seemed to be like a love song. The second one seems to be like when she was in school. And it seems to be continuing on this. Maybe the beginning of this album is going to turn out to be the end of this album.
That's the bolt cutters. I've been in here too long.
This song and the theme of this album seems to be about getting yourself out of situations that you don't want to be in. There's something about the first two tracks where they seemed like incomplete. This track is saying like, okay, you need to get yourself out of this situation. Maybe this relationship isn't right, and maybe you're still attached, and maybe you're just telling yourself that they're a part of it when they're really not. And then the second one seems to be this insecurity, and maybe you need to break away from that too. So, okay, well, interesting that this is brought up so early in the album, though.
So all I could hear was the noise that people make when they don't know shit.
See? I feel like I'm listening to a book right now. There's just so much storytelling in the first three tracks. It's really captivating, really engaging. It's just so well written, like the narrative of this. Like, she said that this like was the last track written for the album or something, but it does sound like it fits very well into this exact socket. There's a lot of experimental shit happening in this album, but it all really complements the music. And it all just kind of adds to the experience, and it's a pretty interesting album so far. It's pretty engaging for how minimalistic it is, how lo-fi it is. Like, I saw the cover of this and I was like, I didn't know what the hell to expect. But now that I'm listening to this album, I kind of get it more, as it looks like one of those close-up selfies you would take if you're trying to do some meme-y shit. Under the table.
I'd like to buy you a pair of pillow soled hiking boots to help you with your climb. Or rather, to help the bodies that you step over so they won't hurt. I won't shut up.
So confrontational.
I won't shut up. Kick me under the table all you want. I won't shut up.
That song was definitely the most direct song on here so far. I mean, it's pretty blunt. I love that. That's a nice little sweet song. It's hard to really say a lot about this since I'm so unfamiliar with this stuff. I mean, I heard her previous project, and that was definitely a lot more subtle than this. There were a lot of powerful moments on there where she was like breaking apart. Here, dare I say, she seems more cheery. There's something about this that's just hard to put my finger on. There's a lot going on here. This is definitely one of those albums you gotta give a lot of listens to. So I'm gonna probably put this on repeat like 10 times in a row tomorrow. For right now, this is really intriguing. The thing that stopped me from checking out Fiona Apple in the first place before the whole Pitchfork incident was the fact that I knew this pretty much singer-songwriter, you know, piano and vocalist. I
hate that.
That's because it's done poorly so often. Next song, Relay. Oh, that's interesting. Yo, she's talking about how evil is a relay sport, which, honestly, you could think about, like, the previous, the track about talking about the school, how there was, like, the bully and whatnot. Can't this song be applied to, like, bullying, right? Considering it's always, like, the cycle of, like, insecurity, you know, the guy who gets bullied becomes the bully kind of thing. Maybe that's what this whole song's about. I kind of like that. This is some brain food right here.
I love the theme of the song.
It's so clever, dude. Yeah, fuck you. This is a total reach, but resenting you for making your life a propaganda brochure. First thing I think of is Instagram, dude. Everyone putting on their fake face. This theme is so cool. Wow, this is just a really creative song. And every single song, like, has a really cool passage that's just doing something that I've never heard before. Like, what the fuck even is this shit? Oh, she's saying I'm sorry. Oh shit, that's her passing the torch. Oh my god. Oh, that's what this is. Right here, this is the... Wow. It sounds all ritualistic and shit too. It's like, oh god, what? This album's crazy so far. I remind you, it's 11 o'clock at night. And And I'm hyped that Fiona Apple. So all of my favorite albums of all time are all albums that like are in some way disjointed, but all kind of come together. Tracks that, well, maybe not the story, you know, all makes sense in total. Say like Shoo Shoo, Grow a Basket of Fruit. I never made a video on this album. I meant to. This was my album of the year last year. And mainly for the same reason that I hear a lot of shit in here. What I loved about that album is it was disjointed. The more I listened, the more the narrative just like flowed together for that whole project. And it just became such a grim and beautiful masterpiece. It doesn't directly tell you like, this is what's happening. And in a lot of ways, that's pretty much just a gateway for me to keep coming back to an album. If I don't immediately get all the details, and it seems like I can interpret this in multiple ways, then it's just gonna keep feeding my brain. That last song was amazing. That was so, like, weirdly ritualistic. I thought the writing on that was just fantastic. It just truly, like, fed into my imagination. So much about that was just so, like, colorful, but also, like, grim. That was definitely one of the songs that, like, lyrically clicked the most so far. Rack of His. Next song, track 6. Wait, Rack of His.
I give you pictures and cards on non-holidays. Wasn't because I was bored. Huh. Followed you from room to room with no attention. Wasn't because I was bored.
She had very similar songs on her last album, where obviously she was giving a lot, like say like Valentine or something, where she was like doing all the work and she never got any appreciation back. And obviously it seems like this is what this song's going to be about. And I love Valentine off the last project, so I really want to see where this goes.
It was because I was loving you so much.
Absolutely crazy. Her singing and her vocal performances so far have been just like off the hook. When she just goes off the rails and she snaps, like the best music comes from sorrow. Realistically, let's not be children here, okay? Best music comes from sorrow. How many of you people have Pharrell Happy in your all-time favorite songs? Okay, you know what? That's just a cheap, that's a pretty stupid example considering nobody does.
Oh,
that atmosphere. That atmospheric pad. It's so cold. I'm gonna be honest, that song didn't feel complete. If you're comparing it to, say, like, Relay. This album, well, there's been a couple of moments that have popped out and really surprised me. Nothing's really taken me back and truly blown me into a psychedelic bliss. In a way, and I didn't really expect this album to. It's slow, but there's so much going on in every second of these songs. Like, it never feels like it's dragging on. There's a lot of ideas. It's packed to the brim. I mean, this is her last album in, what, like, 7, 8 years? I wouldn't expect anything less. Next song, Newspaper. Alright, there's the dog again. There's a reoccurring character. It's bringing her the newspaper? What? Oh my god. I don't know. I feel so weird.
You used to want to be proud of me. And then I just wanted him to make amends. Cause you and I didn't get a witness. We're the only ones who know. It's a shame because you.
What the hell is even going on in this song? The sound of this is just so confusing and baffling to me that it's hard to really pay attention to what's going on. There's the Never Be Friends thing again, and again, she was mentioning how she has trouble making friends, so I can understand where the paranoia is coming from here. I could imagine that situation being very haunting, very disturbing and frightening for someone. Lines like that, you know, I can understand the potential fear of sabotage and just, you know.
Was she,
wait a minute, is this like her ex? Like with her friend? What the fuck is this sound? Dude, this bassy like kick? What is this? This album is so disjointed, like instrumentally. The last album that I heard from her has so much melody. Here it just seems like it's all focused on this chaos. And maybe that's the point of it. Maybe it's supposed to be there's all these chaotic situations that she's trying to cut herself away from. If that's the case, then this is really, really well composed because I feel it. Like, I feel like I understand that clear as day. And it's done in a way that leaves a lot to be questioned while giving you enough to where you understand. That's the perfect little spot right there. You don't want it to be where you're feeding them too much information and it's some boring garbage about how your song won't be on the radio. You just pop 20 Zans and now you're doing 20 handstands. You know what? If I heard someone say that line, I'd probably laugh and say, Hey! But you also don't want to make it just straight up like, you know, cryptic shit that no one understands besides you. No one likes that. Like, come on. At least here, she's very blunt and it feels very down to earth. And because of that, it's very easy to understand and relate to a lot of these situations. And yeah, I like it. What the fuck is this song? Oh my god, I love this aesthetic going on in these tracks, man. That was an absolute disjointed Captain Beef hard banger right there. Like, what do I say to an album like this? This is just so ridiculous. This is really a one-of-a-kind listen so far. I really want to see, like, how this thing, like, changes and turns for me. And maybe it'll grow, maybe it'll shrink. But right now, this is just... this is exciting. This is... this is, like, new. The singer-songwriter elements blended with, like, all of this different shit. I don't even know how to describe this right now. Track 8, Ladies. Is there a single... Wow. I don't think I've heard a single traditional drum beat or drum pattern on this entire album. Everything is so weird. Like this... it just feels playful in a way, you know? What even is this, man?
Ladies.
What the ladies, fuck is even going on, dude? Song. Why is she taking in all these ladies, all these good ladies, and what is happening with this track? What kind of sick fantasy is this? What is happening? It sounds so weird. I love the writing though. I'll say that much. It is so captivating. Like, I really badly want to know what's going on. And I don't know why. I don't know why I'm so intrigued by the narrative of this track. Is she saying here that since no love is like any other love, so it'd be insane to make a comparison? Is she comparing her sorrow and her pain, and this is her going fucking Wendy Williams right here? Ladies, all right. I don't even know how to put my finger on this, but it's just, it throws you all these puzzle pieces. They're like halfway assembled, and it's like all you gotta do is like put the rest of the pieces in. What a weird ass track. There's something about that that's like oddly delusional, but also like it works. Oddly compelling. You kind of feel bad for her at some point. Kind of just lost for words. What do I even say to a track like that? Ladies, that's definitely a confusing, strange, and intriguing track. And I will gladly take intriguing over anything else. Track 9, Heavy Balloons. It sounds like a trip hop beat. Oh, it's just, apparently it's a song about depression. The heavy balloon. That's a cool way of actually imagining that. Like a sweet play with a heavy balloon. We keep it up to keep the devil at bay, but it always falls way too soon. So lost.
so heavy that the bottom is the only place we can find.
That's true.
And like strawberries, I climb like peas.
I don't know how I feel about this chorus though. Something, again, very ritualistic about this song too. The recording of this is really strange. It was definitely one of the shorter songs on here. Alright, it's a very simple song. Doesn't mean it's not good though. I liked it. I wasn't as crazy about it as, you know, some of the other tracks. But yeah, it's still a decent little listen. Cosmonauts, track 10.
Your face ignites a fuse to my patience. Whatever you do is gonna be wrong. Be good to me before you're gone.
What does it matter?
Be good to me, it isn't a game.
Ooh. At least she said that.
Right, left, right. Make lighter of the heavier. Cause you and I will be like a couple of cosmonauts. Except with way more gravity than when we started off.
More gravity. What the hell does it mean? First thing I think about is baggage. I don't think it's that, but more gravity. Maybe he's dragging her down.
With this repetition, it almost shows like this frustration. I think that's really creative.
Any song where there's a specific phrase that's like repeated a whole bunch of times, that always adds to the track, because it seems like it's either like a representing like an endless cycle, which maybe cuts back into the name of this album, Fetch the Bolt Cutters. You know, you gotta cut that cycle off. But it also could mean just essentially this growing intensity, right? It's something to where it's like digging at you. It's like constantly beating you over the head. Like the fact that there's more gravity than it started off. Like this is something that can't be forgotten. And as a result, it's like started off. And like she's just kind of losing it in this track. It's really well translated. Again, it says a lot just through emotion. Realistically though, I can't wait to just kind of listen to this and relax and just like have this on in the background, because I have a feeling that with multiple listens, because the sound of this, every track is just so unique in how it sounds. It's really unique in its ideas. Some tracks build off of each other. I like the weird outros. I actually really like them. I feel like they add a lot. Sometimes they just feel like they're meandering on a track. But there's something weirdly atmospheric, lo-fi, and just kind of engaging and strange about each one of these. They feel like they just hold something to them. It probably helps the album blend better as a full experience too, which is why I kind of want to listen to it uninterrupted. That track was good. I liked it. These have emotional buildups where you can feel something, you know? You can tell that there's something going on here. So when it does reach that peak of intensity, once it gets there, you feel like it's not forced. It's a natural progression. And there's something very human about that. That's why I think also this album, it's not very polished, but it has a very human element. It feels pretty down to earth. I wasn't expecting to like this thing, like, from the album cover. It looked like it was gonna be a little strange, but I didn't expect that strangeness to just be its, like, greatest strength. Like, this is just one of the most, like, flavorful albums I've heard in a while. The amount of spice, the amount of detail here is, like, just so admirable. I mean, I love the fact that there's just so much effort shown in every one of these tracks without going too far. Next song, For Her.
Look at how feathered his cocks are, see how seamless his frocks are. Look at his favorite being over that rock star. Look at how long she walks and how far. Never showing weakness unless it's war season.
Alright, so this is another song scolding a man. Which, to be fair, it sounds like this guy kind of deserves it. Sniff white off a starlet's breast, treating his wife like less than a guest. Getting his girl to clean up his mess. Never showing weakness unless it's a ward session. Nah. You gotta treat women with respect. But it also seems like another situation where this person has to escape, which kind of seems to be a theme of a lot of these tracks.
She's trying to cut the cord. She's tired of playing her.
There you go, cut the cord.
She'll ride and drive her like a soft stop bat. Like he knew you should know, but you don't know where it's at. Like he knew you should know, but you don't know where it's at. Like he knew you should know, but you don't know where it's at. You will ride and drive her like a soft stop bat.
fuck just happened? What? What the fuck is that switch? Wow, that just tripped me the fuck out. What? What the f- Why is that sound so weird, dude? That's so disjointed. And even replaying that, I was like, oh, that's not- Why does that sound so weird? It's like the- What is that blend? What the f-
Why is that so trippy?
That's the most ridiculous thing in this whole album. My brain is like trying to process what the hell just- It's the tempo switch, the drum switch, the fact that there's like some stuff that stays like the same. This is one of the craziest switch-ups I've ever heard. You arrive and die like a soft stuffed bed. Like you know you should know, but you don't know where it's at. You should know, but you don't know what you did. Ah, self-regret for something that's not before. What happened when I came to bed. Like you know you should know. Alright, so this song's about an abusive relationship, obviously. That track is fucking genius. Oh god, I feel like this wrenching. Oh my god. Oh god, that made me feel so uncomfortable at the end there. Wow. That was really unsettling. I mean, I knew this is good, like a blunt album, but like, I mean, it's an unbelievably good song. That goes without saying. But like, man, the lengths it like the where it took it to get there though. I mean, that was such a well put together, complete song. Like showcasing a abusive relationship, a toxic relationship where this man, fucking asshole, man. Like my brain is scrambling. What do I even say to a track like that? Why is it that this after that song, all of a sudden this album cover looks like 10 times more terrifying? That really set me off. That was a really unsettling track. But it also had one of the best switch ups I've ever heard. That switch up was so mind-bending. I gotta move on to some point, so I might as well move on. Track 12, drum set. The drum set is gone. Why did you take it away? That was definitely the worst song on here. Not because it's, like, terrible, it's just really boring. In comparison to the other tracks, yeah, that one really didn't do anything. Maybe it'll grow on me, who knows. On I go, final track. Ah, wow, what a trip. I'm not gonna to ward our way. Up until now it was day next day. Up until now in a rush to prove. Alright, this song seems like it's wrapping up the theme of this album. It's saying like, on I go, not to ward our way. Up until now it was day next day. Up until now in a rush to prove. But now I only move to move. It seems like maybe just saying like moving from tragedy to tragedy. Maybe saying you bring your problems with you. Or something like that. This definitely seems like this is the resolution, though. And I'm glad, because this album needed a resolution. I love this. I'm not gonna to ward our way. Up until now it was day next day. This is demented as fuck. How is this a resolution? This twisted ass sound. What? Oh my god, dude, this sound play. Let's fucking go, dude. Then there you go. Fetch the bolt cutters. Fiona Apple. What the hell? I don't think I could have ever expected an album like this. From what I just heard, I heard such a somber, relaxing listen, with her last project, this is something that's just... What the fuck? How do I even describe this? This album's crazy. This album's absolutely crazy. I don't know if it's just, like, because I haven't listened to a ton of, like, singer-songwriter shit, but I've never heard anything like this. And I don't... It's weird. It's like singer-songwriter blended with, like, a lot of tribal shit. It's experimental. It's off the wall. It's unhinged. This album has a very obvious theme going on, and it seems from the information... God, I have hiccups. I'm yawning. Jesus Christ, man. I'm gonna, of course, you know, give my final score and thoughts tomorrow when I give this a few more listens. This definitely needs a few more listens. But on first reaction, this is one of the most intriguing listens I've heard since probably the Shoo Shoo album. Wow. In terms of concept and writing and keeping me engaged, it's absolutely genius. Like, I think the writing here was top-notch. It was easy to follow along with every single track here, while still giving me a lot of brain food, and that's a sign of a fantastic writer, someone who's not, you know, completely pretentious. Hearing the album, this is the album. What a great cover, dude. I just can't believe I did a complete 180 on that cover, but, like, this is such a crazy, weird album that it deserves such a crazy, disjointed, weird album cover. Thematically, a lot's going on throughout here. Wraps up pretty nicely. I don't think it's, at least as of right now, I think Pitchfork, you know, I can see where they're coming from, but nah, this is not perfect. I want to see if this thing grows on me before I really get to any super crazy conclusions, because, man, I'm telling you, it took like 5 full listens to truly appreciate the last project, so I'm assuming that this project's got so much under the surface that I'm just barely scratching. So, yeah, I'm going to come back to this, and yeah, I love shit. I love the experience of this album. What a trip, dude. Jesus. All right, that's going to be it for me for right now. See you guys tomorrow. All right, it's midnight, and peace out. Stay safe.
There's so much going on. Like, I'm glad I checked out her previous work, because it makes it a lot easier for me to say that this album, there really is nothing like it. Like, I get what Ladies is going for more now. Like, that song seems way less of a crazy, ridiculous track like I thought it was originally. Now it's just kind of more of a chill, relaxing, like... Very sweet track. I love the instrumental to it. Yeah, I'm really loving this. Like, truly. This album's so cool. I'm so glad I have my reaction on camera, because I really enjoyed this. If I had to give it a score, I would give it a 9+ to a 10.